Hello everyone, I'm Cyrus, and today Dr. Nemo is busy doing something very important.
Perfect.
Next!
So, don't worry, I'll take care of today's episode. I'd like to talk to you about some of the coolest and maybe less known evolutionary strategies adopted by marine mammals for the aquatic life. In particular, today, I'd like to talk about a very charismatic animal, the dolphin. Why in the first place did marine mammals go back to the ocean after we spent so much time evolving adaptations to live on land? The fact is that from an evolutionary perspective, if there is the opportunity to make a living somewhere, there is probably going to be someone who will move there just to take advantage of that opportunity. This means that, for example, abundance of prey or avoidance of predators are probably good enough reasons for mammals to move back to the ocean.
Hey Cyrus, we finally made it! We have beautiful and long and steady legs to walk on land. We have lungs to breathe the air. And we also have hair to keep us warm and make us attractive. Hey Cyrus, where did you go? Where did he go? No!
Now, one of the things that you notice when you get in the ocean is that the water is quite cold. Dolphins need to keep a body temperature of about 37 degrees, and that is necessary for their body to work properly. Now, oceans have temperatures that range from minus 1.6 to 33 degrees, which even on the high end of this spectrum, it's quite cold for mammals. Not only that, but water also has a high thermal conductivity, which means that we lose heat much faster in water than we do in air. Dolphins' appendages, such as the flippers and the dorsal fins, have a high surface to volume ratio, which dissipates a lot of heat. And this is not good if you're trying to keep your body warm. So to decrease heat loss in the appendages, the arteries and veins are arranged in a way sought to create a countercurrent heat exchange. Arteries carry warm blood from the core, and when they reach the appendages, they are positioned very close to the veins, which instead carry cold blood from the periphery. The proximity between warm arteries and cold veins causes the blood in the veins to warm up. Therefore, blood returning to the core is much warmer. I'm also sure that you notice that once you get in the water, movement is not very easy. That's because water is much denser than air, which means that movement in water is much energetically expensive. Perhaps the most obvious adaptations the dolphin had for the aquatic lifestyle is a streamlined body, which reduces drag as well as the cost of locomotion. This means that dolphins lost all those features that create drags, such as earlobes, fingers, hair, legs, and protruding genitals. In fact, dolphins' penis and testes are now internal to achieve a more streamlined body. But this adaptation also causes another problem. You see, in terrestrial mammals, testicles extend on the outside of the body because spermatogenesis, which is the generation of sperm, is most efficient at 34 degrees Celsius, which is 3 degrees cooler than the core body temperature. In male dolphins, the penis is retracted inside a fold, and the testicles are found in the abdominal cavity. This abdominal cavity will be too warm to produce sperm. To solve this temperature issue, superficial veins from the dorsal fin carry cold blood and form a countercurrent heat exchanger with arteries that supplies the testes. The cold blood from the veins, which are positioned close to the arteries, cools down the blood that innervates the testes, and this creates a better temperature for the production of sperm. This is the same thing as a liquid cooling system, but for testicles. In addition to that, dolphins have adapted to the challenge of staying warm in water by developing a very thick layer of blubber for insulation.
Cyrus, this is your third box of chocolate. Don't you think you ate enough already?
But Nemo, I'm adapting to an aquatic lifestyle. Another very important aspect of living in water is adapting to dive for long periods of time. Differently from fish, which breathe by extracting oxygen from water, dolphins need to surface in order to breathe because, just like us, they have lungs. Their lungs are the same size in relation to their bodies as many other mammals, but differently from them, they can hold their breath without effort from 8 to 10 minutes. So, how is that possible? Well, dolphins have increased the exchange surface by having many more alveoli, which are very tiny sacs where gas exchange occurs. When diving, dolphins maintain an aerobic metabolism, which means that they use the oxygen stored in their blood, in their lungs, and in their muscles. But first of all, how do you increase the amount of oxygen stored in your body? Well, oxygen binds very strongly with hemoglobin and myoglobin, which are both proteins found respectively in the blood and the muscles. Relative to terrestrial mammals, dolphins have higher concentration of hemoglobin and myoglobin. The ability to exchange more oxygen and to tap into larger reserves of oxygen allows dolphins to dive aerobically for longer periods of time. Another incredible challenge of diving is dealing with a terrible pressure that increases with depth. Water pressure can get so high that it can compress and break your thorax and ribs, as well as make your lungs collapse. So, what's dolphin's solution to this problem? Their thorax is much more flexible, which avoids the ribs and the thorax itself from breaking when under high pressure. While their alveoli and airways are reinforced with cartilage and smooth muscles that prevents them from collapsing. By the way, did you know that Cuvier's beaked whale can hold their breath for 30 minutes and go to depth of about 3,000 meters? At that depth, the pressure is 300 times higher than the pressure that we experience right here on land. Pretty cool, huh? But how does sleeping work for marine mammals? Because, I mean, did you ever try to sleep underwater? It doesn't work. Let's say you're living in water the whole time, and even though you can hold your breath for a long time, you still need to get up to the surface once in a while, you know? So how do you even find time for sleeping? It's not like you can set up a timer every 10 minutes to go up to the surface and breathe.
Hey buddy, you need to get up to get some air. We are running low on oxygen here.
5 more minutes.
But you don't understand. If you don't breathe now, we're gonna die.
But I don't want to get up.
But what are you talking about? Our life depends on this. Cyrus? Oh, shit.
Well, for dolphins, sleep is much different from the rest of terrestrial mammals. While sleeping, both the hemispheres of the brain in terrestrial mammals are subject to a state of sleep. Dolphins instead sleep with only half of their brain at a time, keeping one eye open and the other closed. This is called unihemispheric slow wave sleep, and it allows them to sleep, swim, breathe, and be vigilant all at the same time. This suggests that the two hemispheres of the dolphin's brain are autonomous in many aspects. And this would include the generation and need of sleep. Periods of unihemispheric sleep wave last less than 2 hours, and they alternate between hemispheres so that neither of them experience sleep deprivation. Although on occasion it happens that one hemisphere sleeps a bit longer than the other. In summary, marine mammals made some incredible changes to their bodies, but the most interesting aspect of all of this is that they have used structures that were already present and adapted for a terrestrial lifestyle to overcome the challenges of living in water. So, equipped with all this knowledge and adaptations, it's time to go.